Okay, it's great to be back with everyone. And Shana Tova, I hope everyone had a meaningful Rosh Hashanah. I thank all of you that joined last week or listened online, or many people listened online and the recordings afterwards. And the shiurim are independent of each other, but so clearly they're related to a general theme about meaningfulness as we approach Yom Kippur and questions of mortality. And what I want to focus on tonight is sort of this notion that our fate for the year, as it were, is sealed on Yom Kippur. We're familiar with it in various forms. We'll see some of the Talmudic passages as well, but I think most dramatically with the Tana Tokef prayer, we say Barosh Hashanah Yikatevun V'Yom Tzom Kippur Yichatemun. Right, very dramatic sort of statement. This year, Yom Kippur is also the 50th anniversary of the outbreak of the Yom Kippur War, and that certainly is something that's been on the mind of many people, particularly in Israel. And so we have this notion, which we say in various tefillot, it's part of the additions to the Shmoneh Esrei, of course, and on Yom Kippur, particularly in the Ilah, we stress this point that the Chatima, the final sealing, is going to be happen on this day. And certainly in the tefillah, it's very dramatic, right, that this fate is being determined. Right, who will live and who will die. And it's not just who will die, but how they'll die. Right? And then we get into issues of becoming wealthy or impoverished or whatnot. And then, of course, there's the call out to Teshuva Tefillat Tzedaka Mavir and Teruah Gzerah, that repentance prayer and acts of charity, it's a better translation here, I think, will avert the severity of the decree. Now, what's interesting, however, is that immediately afterwards, and I think I mentioned this briefly last week as well, but immediately afterwards, we have this statement in this very same tefillah, right? In the very same tefillah that we have here, immediately after, we say, God that is slow to anger, and he's quick, noach lirtzot, quick to be appeased. And then we highlight this saying that, ultimately, he doesn't want anyone to die. And he waits till the day of death even for you to repent. Now, this is, I think, a bit of a question that we have to ask ourselves is that if the fate's been sealed on Yom Kippur, then what exactly is God waiting for our tshuva? After all, our fate has been sealed. We just said, of Yom Tzom Kippur Yichatemun. So that's, I think, the open question which I want to focus on tonight. Because if you think about it, and we saw a little bit of this last week, but I want to highlight and express this more. The ultimate Yom Adin that a person faces in their lifetime is the Yom Adin of Yom Amitah, right? Is the day of judgment of their own personal death. And the Rambam, as he continues in his Hilchot Tshuva, in Perek Zion, when he discusses, and he's discussing this throughout, we'll see a little bit of this as we go along, when he discusses this notion of free will, this importance of free will, he stresses this point that person is about tshuva and they can do tshuva until they are the day of death, right? Hol reshut kol adam natuna lo, since you have free will, a person should do tshuva and vidoy, that way he dies, in, right, he's a person who has done tshuva. This is one of the origins of the deathbed vidoy, which unfortunately has gone out of sort of use in the past generations. Although if you've seen some of my recent columns and the Jerusalem Post, there's some links on our website, maybe Rachel, you can put in the chat as well. So you'll see that I'm trying to promote this again. And Ematai has actually produced some very nice PDFs that we've given to chaplains and folders and others to say this. But the idea is when you die, you should die in a state of tshuva. That is the ultimate goal. And therefore, it teaches, La'olam yireh adam atzmo ki'ilu entelamut. The person should see themselves as if they are always facing the possibility of death, right? And person could die suddenly, and they die with sins on their hands, and therefore a person shouldn't delay. Lo yamer shaskina shuv. When I get older, I'll do tshuva. No, shema yamut teri shaskin, because we never know when the day of death may come. Similarly, the Rambam talks about in general, there are certain people that don't get olam haba. There's just grave sins, but then he adds in Hilchot Tshuva once again about im shabman risho umet v'hu bal tshuva harayu zibnei olam haba. If a person has done tshuva and by before they've died, even if they were a terrible, right, rishayim or mumar and all sorts of bad things, whether they do it publicly or privately, if they've done tshuva, chazub tshuva, mekablen oto, Ribbono Shalom accepts them to olam haba. So the Rambam seems to stress a lot here in a lot of different ways, the ultimate day of judgment that really counts is the day of death. You don't want to be about tshuva at that moment. And by the way, this helps us understand the Rambam's explanation. You know, famously, we say that, say, the Torah says that God hardened Paro's heart, and that's why he didn't release the Israelites earlier on. And so you ask, so what exactly does that mean? Takes away the free will, as out loud. And the Rambam teaches us here to tell us that it's precisely this point that what was taken from Paro was the ability to do tshuva, because that's his punishment. Because otherwise, Paro could have done tshuva and died as a Baal tshuva and gone to Olam Haba. It's impossible that Paro would go to Olam Haba. And so therefore, the punishment for the actions which he chose freely is to lose the ability, right, to do tshuva, which is the ultimate punishment, because that guarantees your fate in not going to Olam Haba. So I think what the Rambam is stressing, of course, the Rambam is not making this up. There's certainly sources that indicate this elsewhere, but I think he's the clearest formulation of this, is that the ultimate Yom HaDin, the one that really counts, is the Din of Yom HaMitah. And if that's the case, what exactly is this Yom HaDin on Yom Kippur? Now, I want to just to dramatize a little bit or to exemplify this. We have a neighbor here who I was talking about this. She actually does a lot of work on our graphic design as well, named Yudi Kahn. Does fantastic work for us, for Ematai. And Yudit told me a story not long ago that I think someone in the family or some acquaintance, whatever it was, someone died a couple of days after Yom Kippur. And her younger kids sort of asked, well, what does that mean if this person died right after Yom Kippur? Does that mean they were judged on Yom Kippur and they were judged to be a Rasha and therefore they died? Right, if you think about it, though, that sounds like the implication of this idea, which I think is disturbing on a lot of levels. The primary level, of course, is that there seems to be a little bit of injustice to this, because after all, there seem to be so many people who should be judged poorly on Yom Kippur and yet nonetheless continue to live throughout the year and beyond many years. As we're going to see, this is a question that gets raised and discussed in the medieval commentaries already. But just to highlight what's at stake here, I mean, it's partly like the implications of this concept, but it's also the general relationship to the notion of saying the ultimate Yom HaDin is really Yom HaMitah and the day of death, and that being the case, what exactly are we saying, establishing with this notion of Yom Kippur being the Yom Chatima and the Asar Yom Tshuva being between the days of the beginning and the end process of judgment? So let's see where this idea comes from. It comes, its earliest or clearest manifestation is the Mishnah and Masecha Rosh Hashanah. The Mishnah tells us there are four times of the year when there are periods of judgment. Pesach, on the Tevuah, on the grains, right? Atzeret, al perot ha'ilan, on the fruits, that this is Shavuot, Rosh Hashanah, kol ba'ei olam ovrin lefnei kivnei baron, all the people, creatures, or the world, go past God like the sheep, right? Being judged by the shepherd. Right, and then you get to Sukkot when it's a time of judgment for water, and the Gemara explicates this in greater detail in the name of Rabbi Yochanan, Well, the Gemara tells us on Rosh Hashanah, three books are opened before the Holy Blessed Be, the Tzadikim, the Rishayim, and the Beinonim. Okay, you know exactly what the Beinonim means. There's a bit of discussion. Does it really mean, you know, someone has no sin, Tzadik, right? Or is it just someone who's been deemed worthy? What exactly does it mean? In general, I think we're used to this idea that we should always think of ourselves as Beinonim, right? That we are people that could be go either way. And that comes from a Tosefta and Kedusha and other sources as well. But those are the three categories. The righteous are immediately written and sealed for life. The Rishayim are immediately sealed for death. And the Beinonim wait for their fate to be decided, right, on Yom Kippur. And if that's the case, then this would be the basis for what we now call as the Aseret Yemei Teshuva, right? For these 10 great days of teshuva, of repentance. And the dilemma that comes up here is to understand that basically that sounds like it's all dependent on these 10 days, right? These 10 days is really where the decision is made. And if you look in Rabbeinu Yonah, the great medieval 13th century Rishon, his famous book, Sha'arei Teshuva, we read about last week as well. So Rabbeinu Yonah gives six different ideas to inspire people to do teshuva. And actually, a couple of them relate to mortality, by the way. I think we discussed them briefly last week. But the fifth path, right, the fifth way in order to trigger, right, people do teshuva is to realize, like, we've got the Aseret Yemei Teshuva. And you've got a mitzvah here to do teshuva. And he says, like, just think about it. Man is judged on Rosh Hashanah. The final verdict is the Seder Yom Kippur. And it's at that time when their whole case, right, you know, if your case is being a regular court between a king of flesh and blood, you'd be trembling, you'd be worried. And here we all these Jews in the middle of Aseret Yemei Teshuva, they're running off to work and they're doing this and they're doing that and they're occupying themselves with all sorts of things. Like, they should be minimizing all that stuff. They should just be trembling and thinking, right, about the days of judgment and verdict for which they're facing at this moment. And so what I think you see here is a real clear statement of Rabbeinu Yonah, which says that take this idea seriously. Like, this is just like being before a court case. If you had a major court case during a Aseret Yemei Teshuva, you'd be pushing everything else aside and focusing on that. Here's your opportunity. Focus on everything here now. And, you know, there's a little bit of discussion exactly why this is a time period. After all, you know, Rosh Hashanah isn't marked as a Yom HaDin, right? Or as a beginning of judgment in the Torah. It could be, of course, it's related to Yom Kippur, right? The Yom Kippara, but it's also connected by many commentators to the fact that, at least according to one Mesorah, this was the day of the creation of the world. And of course, Yom Kippur is the day that Moshe and Am Yisrael forget after the Egel Zahav. So it is a proper time in that respect, in order to think about doing teshuva. And so you have here a real clear notion, Rabbeinu Yonah sort of, I think, presenting what I think is the popular conception of Aseret Yemei Teshuva, which says, like, these are the days of judgment. Get your house in order now, because your fate is going to be sealed on Yom Kippur. Now, the Rambam, of course, knows this Mishnah, and in his Perush the Mishnayot, he explained this idea. He says, "V'dana alem b'briyot v'chaim, ma v'chaim," right? Sickness and health and death and life and all sorts of matters of human affairs. And he says the nikla here is obvious, understandable. Aval nistar inino kashem or blistafek. But the concept is clearly very difficult. Interesting. What exactly is the Rambam finding difficult? I suspect the difficulty here might be on a philosophical level, again, relating to the point, why these days, what is this notion, especially if you believe in the power of tshuva, to always return. Now, it could be, you'd say, and there's a parallel of this, which comes up in the Gemara later on, the same daf in Rosh Hashanah, which talks about the Yom HaDin of a day of judgment at the end of days. Right, so there you might say there's a certain amount of finality. And once again, here we have the three groups. We have the Rishayim, we have the Tzadikim, and we have the Beinonim. right? Benonim have a little bit of time, they go down to Gehenna and then they come back up. But that, as a parallel, you understand, well, that might feel like, okay, there's finality there. It should be finality there because that's the ultimate day of judgment. Well, what is this day of judgment in comparison when it comes to an annual day of judgment? So I think that's sort of one question that's bothering. And of course, the other question that's bothering people is, well, you know, and this relates to understanding justice in the world and the righteousness of the world. I mean, after all, you know, is it really true? Do the righteous really get sealed? We see righteous people that seem to die soon after Rosh Hashanah. We see Rishayim who seem to live well, live on, you know, well, happily during the course of the year. And it's sort of the question of theodicy or Tzadik Varado, Rosh Vitovlo. And so here, I think this is one of the factors that pushes the Balei HaTosfot to say the following. You know, we think that this is all about what's happening in this world, judgment in this world. And the Balei HaTosfot, and the Gra actually agrees with the Balei HaTosfot as well, the Vilna Gaon says this also, says that no, this is actually a reference to their status at this point in Olam Haba, meaning the judgment is their current status at this moment for Olam Haba. And, you know, that solves one problem in some ways, of course, because it removes all those questions about, well, is this for like the here and now, for what's going to happen this year? But as the Rashba asked, and he's not the only one who asks on this question, and he says, listen, there are those who say it's Olam Haba, but I don't understand. Olam Haba should be determined by what you deserve when you die, not what you deserve at an annual Yom Kippur. Right? This is something that God judges at the end of the days. And so he rejects, along with many other Rishonim, particularly in Spanish Rishonim, reject this notion and this interpretation of thinking that this is Olam Haba. And instead, they talk about this notion of the benefits of this world, that that's where you're being judged for. And of course, there might be some complications with that, because the way we have a notion of saying that you might get rewarded in this world, so you'll be punished in the next world for Rishayim, or alternatively, that you might suffer in this world because you want to benefit ultimately in the greater world or in the next world. But that is what's going to be determined, according to this, at least, on Rosh Hashanah and Kippur. Again, note already, right, that there is this notion of understanding that something is going to be connected to the Olam Haba as well. That's part of the equation. And so I think the Rishonim are distancing us from just thinking like this is a regular Melech Basar Vadam. This is a regular human being, human court, right? And you're determining what's going to happen here and now. Is the guy going to jail? Is the guy paying a fine? Is he being acquitted? Whoever it might be. And I think there's a push on this thing that divine judgment works a little bit different, but you still have this notion of saying that there is this annual judgment here, which, you know, we have to ask if that's the case, what is that? What is the meaning of that? Interesting, the Ravid sort of modifies this as well. And the Ravid says that it's not really like the type of thing where a person will be sent to death, like, right? It's not how it works. But rather, at that stage, a person's years might be shortened, for example. Meaning if they're destined to live a certain amount, but they're being judged now at a bad level, then their future amount of years will be different. What I want to stress, though, again, and this we see from Rishonim, is that there's an understanding that this is not meant to be referring to the here and now, the present. As if, okay, things are sealed in Yom Kippur, and that's it, right? That's it in the sense of, like, we know exactly what will happen. And I think that part of the reason why the Rishonim are pushing away from this notion, each in their own way, is partly because of a machloket that comes up in the Tosefta already and gets brought down the Gemara. But I think partly relates to this broader question, is there such a thing ever as a final judgment until you get to Yom HaMita? Because do we really believe that person can't do tshuva? Look what we said on Tana Tokef, right? We said of Rosh Hashanah, Yikatevun v'yom sub Kippur yichatemun. But we also say right afterwards, Ad yomoto techakelo. Ribono Shalom is waiting for us. So I think that's part of what's pushing them in this direction to understand that this has got to be, this judgment, whatever's going on in Kippur, needs to be a little more complicated. And it gets further complicated because, in fact, there are positions in the Tanayim, right? We're talking, right, classic early rabbinic sources, Tanayim, right, second century, let's say, CE, who tell us that it's not so simple. Now, we do have the position of Rabbi Meir and Rabbi Yehuda, who do feel that Rosh Hashanah is a significant date. But Rabbi Yossi says, Adam nidon b'chol yom. A person is judged every single day. If you're judged every single day, well, that seems to imply that Yom Kippur is not the final, right, moment of judgment. Now, this also relates to, I think, a different, in a related machloket, about whether there's ever an opportunity to do tshuva after the gzar hadin. You understand, according to Rabbi Yossi, there's a constant process. What about, according to those who think there's a gzar hadin? So it's interesting. If you look at the Medrash Tanchuma, and we look in the Sifri, so we have notions there of saying that, you know, Yisa Hashem Panav Elecha, right? That God's countenance is turned towards us, right? On the other hand, we sometimes say, Lo Yisa Panim. So is God looking towards us? He's not. The answer is, well, if you did tshuva until Chatimat Adin, then, right, he has his grace for you. But after Nechtam, right, Lo Yisa Panim, God is not going to give his beneficence to you. Right? There's a finality to judgment. And we see this in the Sifri as well. The same type of idea where we're told on the one hand, shuva vanim shovim, right, that you can return. And then we say, we can't return. So we say, how does this work out? So ad shelo nechtam gzar din, shuva vanim shovim, right? You can return. But mishe nechtam gzar din, but once the judgment has been sealed, right, it's all over. And famously, famous pasuk is dirshu Hashem behimatzo, which is the Haftorah, right, for Tzomot, and is a pasuk, which we're going to see, is a very important pasuk in which we learn this idea of a Aseret Yemei Tshuva, that is part of the drasha. And so he says, well, is this true? So he say, well, you can find God before the Gzar Din. Once the Gzar Din comes around, it's not a possibility anymore. However, if you look in other places in Chazal, including in the Gemara Nida, right, the Gemara and Nida gives us opportunities where it says that there are indeed times when a person can do tshuva, right? Even lacha gzar din, right? And it's not just here, right? The Gemara talks about one notion, right? The counter notion here, but there are other Gemaras as we see that say that tshuva shemakarat gzar dino shaldam. Tshuva always works. And so the question then becomes, well, does tshuva always work? Or does tshuva not always work? And here, in this respect, the Tosfos says, well, if you're going to say that tshuva works, this must follow a different shita also than Gemara and Rosh Hashanah that talks about shita of Rabbi Yitzchak. The Yitzchak says, crying out to God works, helps, is efficacious, Ben Kodem Gzar Din, Ben La'achar Gzar Din, both before and after the Gzar Din. In other words, what Tosfos is pointing out is that you have different strands of thought within Chazal. Can tshuva, can calling out to God help even after the Gzar Din? Some say no, once it's done, it's done. But others say yes, right? That is always efficacious, and that indeed is why we have a situation where ben kodem gzar din, ben la'achar gzar din, tzaka works. Now, which one is it? How do you reconcile this? And the truth is, I think there's even a bigger question, because it's beyond the question of gzar din right now. it's also a question for us that we have to think about, which is, in practice, do we actually treat Yom Kippur as the finality of judgment? I mean, let's think about it. You know, on Yud Aleph Tishrei, are we going to be praying for people to have a refuah shlema, to be healed? Are we going to be praying for people for parnasa? Are we going to be praying for peace, justice, whatever it might be, of our nation? The answer, of course, is yes. 5 seconds after Ne'ilah, we're going to be saying Arvit. And in Arvit, we're going to say Rafa'enu and Rafa'enu. We're going to include Tfilah. We just, 5 seconds ago, sealed the deal. So if that's the case, what exactly are we praying for between Yom Kippur and Rosh Hashanah? You understand that if you think everything gets sealed in the side between Rosh Hashanah and Kippur, between Yom Kippur and Rosh Hashanah, there ain't too much to pray for. The deal's been sealed already. And the Gemara itself is already sensitive to this, but take a look at the Gemara in Shabbat. The Gemara in Shabbat tells us that there's a teacher of Rabbi Chanina who said, if you have a chole in your house, you should pray for them amongst the chole Israel. And the Gemara says, according to whom is this position? Kaman, Rabbi Yossi. Who is the Rabbi Yossi? As Rabbi Chanina points out right away, Damar Adam Nidon B'chol Yom. Remember, Rabbi Yossi is the position which we saw earlier on in Tosefta. Right, his other places as well in the Gemara. But we saw Rabbi Yossi as well, who was the position which said, right, that there are indeed other signs. Let me just find the Tosefta here. Here we go. Rabbi Yossi is one who said that there are other days of judgment. Every day is a day of judgment. And so what the Gemara seems to be saying, and Rabbi Yochanan now is affirming this, is that if you believe in praying for a refuah shlema on a daily basis, that seems to mean that you don't think that Yom Kippur is where everything is sealed. And in fact, even that same Gemara in Rosh Hashanah, where we talk about the three books being opened, Rav Yosef says, right, who is it, in accordance with who is the position, do we pray daily for the sick and the afflicted? Now, it's interesting. The first answer says, oh, it's like Rav Yosef, meaning it only works. What we do today is the according to the position of Rabbi Yossi. Otherwise, it doesn't make sense. But the second answer of the Gemara says, no, it can even be according to Rabbanan who think that Yom Kippur is Yom Chatimat Din. But they also believe in what Rabbi Yitzchak says. And Rabbi Yitzchak teaches us, Yofet Tzaka Ladam Ben Kurum Gzar Din Ben Lachar Gzar Din. In other words, there might be a Gzar Din, but Tzaka, crying out to God, is still beneficial afterwards. Okay, now if that's the case, the question becomes is, well, if you feel that, either look at those two answers, either we've undermined entirely the notion of Yom Kippur because we pass like Rabbi Yossi, or we've agreed that Yom Kippur is Yom Chitimat Din, but we've said that nonetheless, even after Chitimat Din, Tzaka, calling out to God, is still efficacious. And so the Rishonim here are bothered by this, right? If you look at Rabbeinu Tam and the Balei Tosva here, right, and they say, like, listen, why exactly is Tefillah help? May Rabbi Hudo think that it's time of Din, Rosh Hashanah Yom Kippur time. And so one of their answers actually is to say that, well, maybe Rabbi Meir Rabbi Yehuda think that we should only be praying like this between Rosh Hashanah Yom Kippur and El Chanami. It wouldn't work for them. Our Shimon Esser looked very differently according to Rabbi Yehuda and Rabbi Meir. Right? This would only be something that we would say in between Rosh Hashanah Yom Kippur. There's no point otherwise. But they say in El Chanami, it must be that they too agree as the answer of Rabbi Yitzchak in the Gemara. In other words, if according to Jewish practice today, and then we clearly don't believe that Yom Kippur is the finality of the din. And that's even assuming right, that we're talking about this is this world, but that's not even true, because as we've seen, many Rishonim have brought in factors of Olam Haba calculations into Yom Kippur as well. And so I want to highlight already at this stage that it's understood in the Rishonim that this notion of the finality of Yom Kippur, right, it has to be moderated somehow, it has to be modified somehow. Because at the very least, even if we hold like Meir Rabbi Yehuda, which seems to be our practice today, right? So our tefillah, we acknowledge Yom Kippur to be the day of Yom Adin, we nonetheless seem to rule like Rabbi Yitzchak and seem to rule that afilo achar gzar din, things can be changed. And the question is exactly, how does this work? So one formulation of the Ran, Rabbeinu Nisim, it's very interesting. He quotes later on the Gemara as well, comes up, where the Gemara makes a distinction between prayer in private and prayer b'tzibur. And the Gemara seems to tell us that prayer b'tzibur, right, is more efficacious. When you daven with the tzibur, when you daven including the tzibur, when the tzibur is in your mind, so you have a much more efficacious prayer. And therefore, Rabbeinu Nisim says, Enachinami. It could be that the gzar din on the yachid is sealed on Yom Kippur. But nonetheless, when you're a part of the tzibur, as opposed to the yachid, when you're part of the group, right, then it can still be torn apart. And therefore, he says, right, don't go with this difficult answer of the Balei Tosfot, but rather say that we do believe that things may change as long as you're part of the tzibur. And that's why in the Gemara and Shabbat, Dafka tells us, if you have a chole in your house, what should you do? Pray for them b'toch shar chole Yisrael. That's what we say in our Nusach today. Or we do a tefillah for a Refuah Shlema. We say always b'toch shar chole Yisrael. Why? Because we're A, we care about the L'cholim, and B, that we believe that there's something special about being a part of the community. And according to the Ran, what's special is that you get judged differently and you have the opportunity for the breaking up of the Gzar Din. Now, it's interesting. There are those, however, who want to sort of preserve the strong view of saying that this is a finality, right? There is actually a Yom Kippur. And so you see some approaches which say, well, it could be that your fate on some matters of what you'll get is sealed Yom Kippur, but the implications of that might be different, changed. And so if, let's say, for example, rain. It could be a certain point of the year, the amount of rain is declared. But, you know, is it going to be rain as beneficial or not beneficial? Well, as we know, sometimes rain can be small amounts, but if it's the right time, it stays in the right place, goes to the aquifers, etc., it's a lot better position. And so one approach here is to say, well, that at least can be changed over the course of time. That's an interesting approach, which says, right, that Yom Kippur is the day where things are sealed, but the implications of that can be changed. And the same thing that goes to your health, you know, and many other things. I think that's a difficult answer, though, because ultimately it doesn't feel like what type of judgment is going on here. And so I think the Ran and Ben Yoyada and others are sort of struggling here, but these are interesting answers to how to deal with this issue of our practice. I'll show you also the Turi Evan in his commentary to Rosh Hashanah. He has a very interesting approach in which he says that, well, tshuva alone wouldn't work outside of Aser Yemei Tshuva. But if you're crying out to God, meaning it's a different level that's necessary after Aser Yemei Tshuva, that works. Very interesting, right? Rabbi Yitzchak said, tzaka, calling out to God, is significant. And so what the Turi Evan is saying is that in Aser Yemei Tshuva, just doing repentance is enough. After Aser Yemei Tshuva, if you want the din to be changed, you need to do it, combine it with really heartfelt calling out to God. Once again, I think he's just sort of struggling here, trying to understand. Our practice acknowledges that after Yom Kippur, things are still possible to change. And if that's the case, what is the significance of Yom Kippur? My favorite answer to this question is the answer of the Ritva. The Ritva in Spain, one of the great Rishonim. So he gives a couple of these different answers that we've seen already. And then ultimately he comes and says, Vasikta, the end of the Gemara, Dafilu Temek Rabbanan, even if you hold like Rabbanan, meaning Yom Kippur is the Yom Machatima. But nonetheless, Kerabi Yitzchak, Dafilu Biyachid, Yafet Zaka Afar Lachar Gzar Din. But nonetheless, even the rabbis hold that after Yom Kippur, after the Gzar Din, calling out to God, right? It's a part of a Teshuva process, is sufficient. Vahai Ukimta Ikar, Vahai Chisugam Bacho Duch the Tamura. Afa gav the late Hilchot Rabbi Yosi v'hachi minhaga the alma. Very, very interesting. What does he say here? He says as follows: we rule against Rabbi Yosi. Right? Rabbi Yosi, who said that you're judged every day, Rabbi Yosi, who denied the significance of the final judgment Yom Kippur, we don't agree with that. Instead, we follow the position of the rabbis who say the Yom Kippur is the day. But we also say that even after Yom Kippur, tshuva of a yachid, of an individual, with the tzakah, the calling out, is sufficient. Now, friends, I think the Ritva is right that this has to be the answer. In practice, we seem to say in our tefillot, in the Mishnah, right, in many ways, we say in all sorts of different ways, Yom Kippur is the Yom HaChatimah. Because they went sealed. Aser Yomei Tshuva is days of significance. But we also say 3 seconds after, after Ni'ilah, right? That God, right, has mercy on us. How many sins did you do between singing Shema Yisrael and the beginning of Maariv? I mean, when you're dancing around singing Lashana Ba, were you talking Lashon Hara about the Chazen, right? Were you cutting someone off in the dance circle? So nonetheless, right, we seem to be saying right away, we're keeping on calling out to God a moment after Ni'ilah. And so I think the Ritva is highlighting is that we seem to retain both of these notions. A, that Yom Kippur is a significant day of the sealing of the 10 days of repentance, but that even after Yom Kippur, any day, anytime, even the Yachid, can call out to God after the Gzara Din and be Chozer B'Tshuva, and it'll be accepted. And if that's the case, what exactly then is the point of the Seri Yemei Tshuva? Because if you have like what Rabbeinu Yonah, I think that was stating in the popular conception, this is the day of judgment. This is where it's all sealed. So you understand the point of the Seri Yemei Tshuva is. But if you hold, and I think this is how we do hold, right? This is certainly our practice is that we agree with Rabbi Yitzchak that Yafet Zaka Af Lacha Gzaradin. If that's the case, what exactly is the meaning of these Aser Yemei Tshuva? So I want to show you two formulations that I find meaningful. One of the Rambam and one of the Me'iri. Hey, the Rambam, remember we saw the Rambam. He says, you know, there's a little bit of a sod, right, that's difficult to understand about the Seri Yemei Tshuva. But the Rambam tells us, Afa Pisha Tshuva Tzaka Yafa Laola. Tshuva and calling out always work. Basar Yamim Shebe Rosh Hashanah Yom Kippur, right, but those 10 days, Yafa Biyoter, Umitkabelet Him Yad. Right, the Rambam says that somehow these 10 days, it is more efficacious in the sense that it's accepted faster. And he says, though, but this is only true for the Yachid. When it comes to the Tzibur, when it comes to the whole congregation, it doesn't matter. They'll be accepted right away if they're doing Tshuva and calling out to God, B'Lev Shalem. So it's interesting, the Rambam minimizes the significance of a Seri Yemei Tshuva for the Tzibur. And for the Yachid, he seems to be saying, well, it's a little bit beneficial that it gets accepted faster. But that's it. So if you think about it, the Rambam is clearly sort of, I would say, is not entirely minimizing Asayim Mechuvah. It's important. And he talks about the various minhagim that we do Asayim Mechuvah, Slichot, and whatnot. But it seems clear that the Rambam doesn't think it's of critical importance, because after all, Tshuva Tzaka Yafel Ona. And I think this leads me to discussing the Chibor Tshuva that is written by the Meiri, Menachem Meiri, great rationalist of Provence, southern France, medieval 13th century. And he has a beautiful extended essay, if you will, on Tshuva. And he discusses here this notion of Yeshua Hashem B'Matzo, that we find God, right? We seek God and find him. And he talks about this notion and says, listen, what does this mean, Yeshua Hashem B'Himatzo? And he says, what does this mean? He translates from Yonatan ben Uziah. And Yonatan ben Uziah teaches in his Targum, Shidreshub od Chaim, right? Search God when you're still alive. The goal of seeking God is make sure you find God before you die. And which is something we saw earlier on. Right? This notion of saying the ultimate goal is to die as a Baal Tshuva. As someone said Tshuva. Because God is close to us in our life. It's funny because we usually think of like Olam Haba ideas, right? But what he's saying is no, that time when you can seek and find God is in this world. She'ein tshuva lanefesh achar mita, because after you've died, what do you got? Right? You don't have the ability to tshuva. Ki'ein masa b'cheshvom adav b'chachma b'she'ol, right? There's nothing in the nether world. There's no opportunity here. And so what we're trying to do always is say, make sure to reach out to God in this world. Well, if that's the case, what does this have to do with Asayim Mechuva? So he says, Chazal, right? The rabbis darshan it. Rabbi Tani Pirshu B'Himatzo, Kodem Gzar Din, meaning find God before the Gzar Din. Why are they telling us to find God before the Gzar Din? They tell us, right, this idea of saying, right, that the Yachid and Tzibur, the Yachid should fear the 10 days between Rosh Hashanah and Kippur. And it should be a day when we are Mishtadel Tamid B'Tshuva, right, that we are establishing a time in order to search for Tshuva. Why do we do that? So he explains. Rasa B'zeh Sha'ami Yot Adah, Sh'im Ayot Adah Mitzvich Shidel Tamid B'Tshuva, he says, listen, human nature is such that if we don't have a designated time for tshuva, what would happen? We won't do it. We're busy. Life, things are going on. And so in order to force a person, right, to think about this, this is a wild line of the Meiri. He's saying that's one of the great, right, phenomena of the ways of religion, that we've established time to get the entire people to do tshuva. Right? And this will also bring along not just the nation, but the individuals. Because when you do things as part of a klal, when it's a standard of the congregation, when it's a standard of the people, then it's going to bring along the individual as well. This is a really remarkable passage, because what the Meiri is saying is what we saw initially. The goal is to find God, right, before you die. That is the ultimate goal. Now, by the way, you can say if that's the case, well, that's great. But keep in mind, we didn't see this, but there are other Gemara to talk about. Of course, if you lose God before you die, then you're in trouble, right? It's a scary thought as well. meaning a person can be kona olam haba and be baal tshuva right before they die. They can also lose it all right before they die. So it's a scary thought in a lot of ways, but the point ultimately is to say that this is a life process and you want to find God because you can find God in this world. This is your opportunity. If that's the case, why do we have these 10 days? And he says, what a great phenomenon that these 10 days have given us, that normally people wouldn't be able to focus on repentance and cheshbon ha-nefesh, right? Introspection and soul searching. But we've created a culture in where every year for 10 days, we of course started with Elo beforehand, right? We build on this idea of saying it's time for introspection. What a wonderful idea for ourselves and for the world. And I think this is a really important statement of the Meiri, because I think what the Meiri is really highlighting for us is as follows. Yes, there is this notion of Chatimat Adin, and it's significant that we see ourselves on an annual year and an annual level being judged. What are we being judged for? For this world, for what we benefit in this world, for Lama Ba, Machlok Rishon, we don't know. It's not so much important about what we're being judged, is that we feel that we're being judged. It's that we have that internalization of the sense of saying we stand before God with our community, all of us, the entire world, right? And we are judged. Not in a, you know, people like don't like this idea today. It's so bad, judgmental. No, no, it's a favor to us, right? It's this idea which says that every year, what a powerful idea this is. We should be thinking about what is the meaning of life? How we're behaving? Can we do better? And of course, it shouldn't be just a trick, you know, what we do between Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur. It's what we do between Yom Kippur and Rosh Hashanah that's so critical. But the purpose of the 10 days of repentance is to give us this gift of making us think that we have to do this accounting in order to have a meaningful life. Because as he says, once we're no longer in the world of living, there ain't much more we can do. I think this is a beautiful way of understanding and practice how we live our ritual. On the one hand, Rosh Hashanah Yom Kippur, the stress, language, is certainly one of Yom HaDin, but we also seem to believe that this should carry with us for the rest of the year as well, which is why we pray throughout the year for Refuah Shlema, we pray for Parnassah, pray for a lot of things, and which is also why we pray and acknowledge the fact that we should be constantly doing tshuva throughout the year. That's also part of our prayers, because we believe, like Rabbi Yitzchak, the Yofet Tzaka, that it's appropriate both before and after the Gzar HaDin. And so I hope in conclusion that if we think about it this way, we'll go into Yom Kippur, or go in the last days of Aseret Yemei Tshuva, understanding that the one, and this is a golden opportunity that we're being given. It is a special time. It's a time when everyone comes together and there's something special about people praying together and doing self-reflection together. And in that sense, the Rambam's formulation is very telling, right? There is something very special about Aseret Yemei Tshuva in our tshuva being accepted. But it's not the be-all and end-all. It's the beginning. It's the beginning of the process of what happens between Yom Kippur and the next Rosh Hashanah. And ultimately, it's just the next stage of until the final Yom HaDin of Yom HaMitah. So I leave you with that thought. Thank you so much for joining. Shana Tovah, Gemar Chedima Tovah. It should be a wonderful year of healthy and happiness for all of us.